sit in the precept on precept. Kept the shit, break it down to no meat left. Line upon line in the word, make you respect. History collision when we teach it, brains reset. You listen in the precept on precept. Kept the shit, break it down to no meat left. Line upon line, the word make you respect. History collision when we teach it, brains reset. Putting in the work for the most high. Valley of the bones coming back and we gon' rise. Showing you our past didn't stop with that boat ride. We a nation made of kings, yeah, we chose right. Bringing our identity back. We the praise of the Lord, they pretend to be that. Shooter is something special, they could never be that. We raise the bitches with the knowledge so our enemies crack. In fact, listen to the class in the topic. Bomb subject matter, breakdowns of topic. Gathering the people to hold duty and profits.
Israel united in Christ. We are not a hate group. We are not affiliated with any other Israelite group. Israel United in Christ is a nonviolent Bible-based movement. We do not advocate or condone any acts of violence against any race, ethnicity, or gender. We advise that if anyone hears or knows of any plots to cause harm to anyone or to break the laws of the land, you must contact the proper authorities to bring awareness to any possible threat, as stated in Leviticus chapter 5, verse 1.
Hey, shalom, y'all. Hey, Most High in Christ bus. Hey, shalom. We are precept upon precept. Sorry for the technical difficulty. Abiel, thank you very much, Captain Abiel. Most High in Christ bus. Welcome to another edition of Precept Upon Precept. We are your hosts. I'm Captain Sherman to our left.
Officer Matthew.
Officer Mikael.
All praise to the Most High. So tonight, we're going to jump right into it. Pull up the first video. I know it's from the Telegram, like you said, Akiem. But can we take a look at right below the video that it was from? It should say, Kazakh crisis update, dozens of protesters are killed. I want that short video. Can we do that real quick? A lot of you have might have stumbled across this major uprising over there in Central Asia. It's a former Soviet nation that... that, as some of you know, the USSR, when those of us who are in our 40s, it was big when we were kids. The USSR dissolved, and the Soviet Union had countries that broke off from it. And we're going to get into that tonight, because what's going on over there is a major deal, okay? Rioting of significant proportion. Let's show that here, and then we're going to go into some history, and we got some articles that we want to get into tonight. So y'all hang out for about an hour and 25 more minutes, all right? Let's play that. So let's just stop real quick. So what you're seeing here is a GIs, I can't pronounce it, somebody help, is it Kazakhstan? I can't pronounce it.
Kazakhstan.
So what we're seeing right now is either some sort of M16, some sort of AK, probably an AR-15 style of weapon. They are in Kevlar helmets, which means they're in battle gear. They are in BTUs. This is a military, and they are shooting not rubber bullets. So, and there is a military tank with a guy sticking out the top of, it's not a 50 cal, but he's got, would you say that small arms officer, Matt? Is that small arms fire right there still?
Those are assault rifles. Those are M16s, might be M4s. That's a long muzzle, so it might be 16s.
So definitely beyond riot gear. So when we look at this, is this a war? That's what we are we looking at a war? Let's find out what we're looking at. Play on. So now, pause. What we see in the back is we see close quarter troops, and obviously they're getting some sort of instructions. Perhaps they have riot gear. I can't really tell from this angle. They're forming up, and those are military transport vehicles that we're seeing. I just want you to see that this is actually protesters in the countries of, I'm going to get the name wrong every single time,
Kazakhstan.
This is what's going on. Play on. Let's take a look. All right. Now, that's all we needed real quick. So now, there's another video I want you to pull up because I want Esau to explain it to us because we're going to get a Western point of view right now. There's a video that I put up. ABC, yes, sir. Because ABC is going to give you all basic Caucasian news. We'll give it that acronym because that's what it is. Bishop comes up with the colorful acronyms on a roll like him.
All about Caucasians.
All about Caucasians. So what we're going to do is, and you Puerto Ricans ain't Caucasians, by the way, and you Dominicans, and you light-skinned so-called blacks who think that you're accepted. Go ahead and play that.
Many of them have been governed by so-called strongmen, authoritarian leaders.
Is it playing low like that?
One of them, the situation there okay. on the ground, as you say, just developing right. rapidly. We've seen these
So look, so
protests.
Now we're seeing, before, what we were seeing was a cell phone camera. Now we're seeing more of news cameras, and of course, we've got a Western editor. All right. As long as they can hear it online, it is what it is. Thank you. Thank you very much, tech team. Thank you very much. We appreciate you. Play on.
Gripping cities across this huge former Soviet country. I mean, Kazakhstan okay. is about the size of Western Europe.
Okay, now stop. This is the point I wanted. So Kazakhstan, in case for you at home, is about the size of Western Europe. So real quick, tech guy, put up a geographic map of Kazakhstan, and then I want you to get me a map of Western Europe. I want to show you a scale of how big this landlocked country actually is. And brothers, if you got something to say, please chime in. Right now, a lot of people do not know that this is even going on right now.
Hey, Cap, they could just pull up the Wikipedia that I posted.
Pull it up.
Pull up the Wikipedia, the very last thing that I just posted in the chat. It should show you a map of the world and Kazakhstan.
Beautiful.
And somebody right get there at the top.
Get the tech team some coffee. This guy, get him a Jolt Cola or something. This guy, wow. Who's back there? All right. Where we at?
It's right there at the
top. It's in the Wikipedia. Hey, but look, Cap.
It says location of Kazakhstan, Central Asia.
Yo.
Looking at that video, it reminds me of Tiananmen Square in Beijing when they had that protest and the Chinese army came against them.
It looks like
the same thing.
Yeah.
Right. And the thing is, what we get to later on, you're going to find that this is primarily an Islamic country. Mm-hmm. And this is not a democratic ruled country. Okay? What you're going to find is a lot of people are dying over there. This is not like, in Portland, Oregon, when they're setting buildings on fire and they're being pardoned and they're having wars nightly in the streets and, just don't make sure. No, they're not using rubber bullets. They're not using they're killing people.
Yeah, Cap, this is not a Western riot.
No, it's not.
Right.
This is not a Western riot. They got some real stuff going on over there.
It's the real deal. Let's get that map so we can put it in perspective because a lot of us really don't pay attention.
Yeah, zoom in. Zoom into that. Because we want that map right there. Because the green is Kazakhstan. Yeah, the green is Kazakhstan. To the left of that is Europe.
Western Europe.
Right. So if you look, let's put it in perspective. If you look at if everybody at home takes a look at the green, right? If you look, there we go. Let's look at the green in relationship to the continent of Australia. Australia is at the bottom right of the screen.
Yeah.
And that isn't the only, it is a country and a continent, Australia. And it is fairly large. Because Kazakhstan is, I mean, it's smaller, but I mean, it's a large country. And those of you, if you look directly above Africa, you can see that the Mediterranean Sea, it is almost, well, not quite, but it is almost the size, if you look where the Iberian Peninsula, where Portugal, France, Spain, all it's about the size of Western Europe. It's a big area we're talking about.
Hey, Cap, it's bigger than India. It's bigger than Saudi Arabia.
Right.
It's bigger than Afghanistan, Iraq. It's bigger than that whole little area in the Middle East that they call the Middle East.
Right.
It can fit over Western Europe, where Britain is, and the Ukraine and all of that stuff.
Also, right, the importance of its geographical position, it quite literally is in the center of Asia, right?
Yep.
Look at to the north of Kazakhstan is Russia. Thank you, tech team. Bear with us. So we always take a couple minutes, look at the relationship of where this is at. There we go. All right, so look, it is, you got the Cap CNC. Other than that border of that large lake of water, it is land bound. Mm-hmm. To the north is pretty much entirely, scroll up a little bit. Let's see if we see Russia, the word Russia. Can we do it?
Yep.
Now you can come back down a little bit. We know it's Russia. So pretty much the entire northern border and part of the western border, all of the western border for that matter, is the capital in Russia. All of the northern border is Russia. Now to the east, right, if you look at it, it is China. Now, why is this an important region? Why, you might ask? Well, because it's a region. Google, give me Wikipedia. Give me Wikipedia, please. Why is it being destabilized right now, and what is the purpose or the intent behind this riot? Is it because it's just a great place to go and they're just being treated unfairly? Or is something else going on behind the scenes, and is Esau, is the American damn devil, somewhere probing along? That's what we're going to get into tonight.
Well, Cap, the white woman, I have to say with the H, the white woman,
right,
said that the United States has nothing to do with this.
Right, yes. Hey, let's get that in the queue, because that's why would the U.S. have to come on and defend themselves?
Yeah.
Why would a white representative from the United States, who is some sort of speaker of something, why would we have to say, we meaning the United States, that we weren't a part of it? Because the U.S. has historically been in most coups throughout the earth.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
And we're going to find, I'm telling you, you got the Wikipedia? Now, so let's, but what I would like is Kazakhstan. If we can scale back. So we can see a little bit less font, right? The president, we can go back to the president in a minute because that's going to be important. But right now, I just want Kazakhstan. All right. So real quick, do me a favor. Get me Micah chapter 2. Is it that what I want? I want, and he's enlarges his borders as hell. Is that what I want? It might be Habakkuk. Let me see. Take a look at it. Put it, get and enlarges his borders as hell. It's either Micah 2 or Habakkuk chapter 1. Let me look at it real quick. While we wait for tech team. You got it? Okay. Look for that in Micah. He enlarges his border.
Yeah, I got you, Cap. The book of Habakkuk chapter 2, verse 5.
Y'all listen. Because if you think that the good old U.S. of A. has nothing to do with the destabilization of this country, you're in fantasy land. Read.
Yea, also because he transgressed by wine.
What is the wine? Does that mean that you see every single Edomite walking around drinking a Remy, whatever the hell wine they drink now? Read.
Yea, because he also transgressed by wine. He is a proud man.
So this wine is not talking about little wine. And this proud man is, you can't tell him nothing. He can go where he wants, do what he want, take what he want. That's when you're proud. He could do whatever you want, and nobody can stop it. Hell, they brought the world court. They tried to bring the world court against Esau and George Bush. They still went to war. Y'all remember that? Mm-hmm. They still went to war. There was a protest in Washington, D.C. years ago, and the U.S. still went and waged war. Proud man. Read on.
Neither keepeth at home.
And what the hell is Esau doing in a 72% Islamic country destabilizing that land right now? What is he doing? Read on.
Who enlargeth his desire as hell.
He What is Esau's desire in this land? That's what we're about to get to. Is that it?
And is as death and cannot be satisfied.
Because it's a destabilization based upon a commodity. Because why? You're seeing shortages all over the world, and there's trade wars that are going on behind the scenes. The U.S. is looking for new ways to do business and to save on cost. Now, and you mark my words. You think you might think, no, it's got no, it's got something to do with it, Kazakhstan. So let's go to, scroll down real quick. I want the history. Blah blah blah. Let's see. Okay, there we go. Go down to where it says the next indentation or separation. Kazakhstan is the most, right there. There we go. There we go.
Kazakhstan is the most dominant nation of Central Asia, economically and politically.
That's what I want. Mm. So Kazakhstan is the most dominant nation in Central Asia. Okay, there's a lot of countries in Central Asia, right? And it generated 60%, which is almost two-thirds of the gross
domestic product.
Domestic product. Okay, I see where they did that. It should have been national, but domestic product, I guess that's a regional thing. Read on.
Generating 60% of the region's GDP, gross domestic product, primarily through its oil and gas industry.
So that is what Esau is after. It is a huge gas and oil industry. And guess what? It is 70-something percent Islamic. So, let's read on. Why do you keep taking this?
Article back up.
All right.
It also has a vast mineral resource.
Now, I'm going to take a little time on this. Why is it important that a country that is the highest gross domestic product level, which is the strongest politically and economically, that has oil and gas and minerals? Why all of a sudden is there a destabilization, rioting, and turmoil in this country? And by the way, there's a part in this Wikipedia. There's different levels of safety that Esau rates a country. For example, a level one is a place where you can bring your family and vacation. It's really, really nice. Germany and France are level two, and that's a first-rate country. Kazakhstan is a level one country, meaning it was very safe before this whole thing started. So now all of a sudden, it's a first-rate country in a category one, and now there's destabilization? No. If we could leave that article up. So we're going to do some searching. I want us to go to, it is a place where it talks about rating. Scroll down. Political system reforms, elections, urban centers. Go to urban, municipal divisions and urban centers, because, and it might be 4-5, 4-6, and 4-7, because what we're going to try to find is, I guess, go back up, please. Leave it on municipal divisions real quick. I'm scrolling through it. Bear with oh gosh. Scroll down. I gotta get this. Scroll down. Foreign relations. Okay, hold on up. Oh man, I wanna get this. Scroll down. Yes. What it talks about is a level one when it comes to safety or trying to get their destination. It's a safe place, and I want to use the words. Yes, it says level one or. Yes. All right, so y'all look for that. But in the meantime, can we play a video while you look for that as well? Is that possible? I want ABC News. I want us to go back to that video. Is it still going to be quiet? All right. Because we got to be able to hear the commentary in order to help to. All right, go ahead.
Demonstrations, as you say, sparked.
So we're just gonna let this video play, and you at home will be able to hear this, just so you can get a little bit of background.
Made a whole bunch of concessions.
There we go.
The government there is a major energy producer, but as I say, it's been dominated by this authoritarian father figure, or father of the nation, he's been likes to be referred to, of Nursultan Nazarbayev. He's a former Communist Party boss and a key ally of Russia's Vladimir Putin.
So real quick. So one thing that the U.S. has got to be careful of is that Russia is Vladimir Putin is has ties to this guy. So, and most of their border is engulfed by Russia or surrounded by Russia to the west and most to the north. So it says that it's a powerful 60% of the gross domestic product, the political and the economical power that this country has, and its close ties to Russia, right? So play on.
Hey, Cap, real
yes,
quick.
Sir.
That he said that a lot of that country deals with power, not just political, actual electricity power. Now, that, I'm telling you, that is for y'all brothers out there and y'all sisters out there doing these trading things. This is why we need to touch on this stuff. Because you're looking at Kazakhstan like, oh, well, it's Kazakhstan. You know, they over there doing that. Ain't nobody worried about that. Oh, wait till you see later on in the show. Kazakhstan has a big impact on a lot of things that our people like to trade and like to do. They have a big impact on that.
Mm. Yes. So where we going to play that video, right?
He's going to be looking at what's going on. No one more closely than Vladimir Putin and the Kremlin, who, of course, are nervous about the signs of any kind of popular uprising on their doorstep. We saw their reaction with Belarus. Today, they're saying they're watching the situation closely and urging other.
Are they watching online at home? Okay, we're going to talk. All right, bear with us. All right, real quick, can we get another article or while you wait to queue that up? All right, so go to, back to Wikipedia.
Brilliant helps you see math in a new way.
And I want you to go where it says mining. Because remember, before, y'all, it talked about it was rich in oil and gas, and it also said minerals. What are we finding out through this COVID-19? There's a shortage of what? There's a shortage of microchips in a lot of these automobiles, equipment that have electronics, other major, because everything's chipped now. Before, it used to be carburetors and cars had very little. A motorcycle today has all types of a bus, a school bus, a train, cars, planes, Super Nintendo, whatever the hell they got with it.
PlayStation 5.
7 or 5, whatever it is. All of these different things require microchips, and guess what? minerals come from minerals. Mm-hmm. And if China in the Far East, if you will, is going back and having wars behind the scenes, guess what the U.S. has to do? They have to find other ways to secure these chips. That's why they was doing the things they were doing in Haiti, because they found out there's a great chip there. Now they're already interested in Haiti. So if we can play the Wikipedia where it talks about Kazakhstan and it went down to mining or minerals, please.
Yes.
Yes.
Mining and metallurgy.
All right, we're going to get it. Y'all be patient with us. Metallurgy, which is the, basically it's mining and what they do to process those metals. Tech team. Y'all be patient with us today.
Hey, first day back, Cap. First day back.
Okay. All right, now. Hey, Akim. While we get this right, I want you to, if you can, have another article going in the back. It is, there's a quick article. Bear with us. It talks about, I got to get it. It lines up with it.
These
About mining, about microchips and, hang on a second. Electronics manufacturers. It was right below Officer Matthew did the Bitcoin article. Landlocked country Kazakh with minerals. How are microchips manufactured? Get that article. It was www.ipc.org. All right, beautiful. So we'll come back to that, but let's go to the Wikipedia article. Bear with us, y'all. We're a little slow. A little slow today. Damn. We can't see nothing. Okay. But what I'm hoping to do is get Wikipedia and then come to that. All right. So Wikipedia on metallurgy and mining, and then we're going to go back to the other one that you just had. All right. So go ahead.
All right. Mining and metallurgy. Kazakhstan has vast deposits of uranium.
Uranium. If I'm not mistaken, because I actually sold the system to a rocket scientist the other day. He's in rocket science and nuclear engineering. One of the Edomite, but super, super smart guy. And we were talking about this and how Donald Trump wanted to buy Greenland because Greenland is rich in metallurgy and all type of minerals and other precious metals necessary for nuclear reactors.
Uranium is the number one needed mineral for nuclear reactors and nuclear bombs, nuclear technology.
So this is heavy. So we see that when we pull back the proverbial curtain, we see how could a first-rate country that got its independence in 1991, had a president for 28 years when you do a little research, and now all of a sudden, out of nowhere, right, it hits the news. Gas, and by the way, what set the country ablaze like this is gas prices effectively doubled overnight. Now, I don't know if it was 4 days or 3 days. Gas, that's like saying this, y'all. Y'all roll with us. Imagine right now, we in New Orleans, about $3, $3.15 a gallon, right? Some of y'all is a little more out in the West Coast. Some of you might be like $2.80 a gallon. Can you imagine tomorrow, if in California and you're $4 a gallon, tomorrow if it jumped to $8 a gallon? If in New Orleans it jumped to $6.60 or $6.30 a gallon? Do you know what that would do to the country? Overnight, everything would change. Food distribution price would go up because transport of the semi trucks, the stores and food would raise the prices to accommodate that to make up for the fees. Uber Eats would raise their prices. Any type of transport of food would go through the roof. Okay, and as a result, the cost of living would go up. and everybody would be affected, and it would take days and a couple of weeks and months. You would see public outcry, and that's what's going on right now over there. But I wonder why. Why did this happen? There's something behind the scenes that y'all got to see what's going on here. Where there's smoke, there's going to be a fire. So read on.
Kazakhstan has vast deposits of uranium, precious metals, metals, ores, alloys, ferroalloys, and minerals.
Remember, alloys and ferroalloys and minerals. Officer Mika, you about to say something? Not yet. Pull up, because I need my nerds. Mikael is a bright IT guy.
Nerd.
And, right. We all nerds. We all wear
nerd.
Glasses.
Nerd. I'll be a nerd.
I'm a nerd, too. I got four eyes. I've been wearing glasses for 25 years. Look, go to that article, because there are certain minerals and other things that are required for mass production of microchips. Okay? Beautiful.
All right, IPC. Electronics manufacturing outlook continues to darken. Prices increase as component shortage drags on.
So this is why, this is one of the major reasons why there is a public outcry in Kazakhstan, because companies are going through this. Let me give an example. We have lead times now of 6 to 8 months on some of the products that we sell at the company I work for, where it used to be 3 to 5 business days, 14 business days. Now it's 6 to 8 months, because it's not the actual housing, it's the microchips that go in it. They got thousands of cars right now, newer cars. They cannot get them off the lot because they did not complete production because of a lot of the advanced systems on these cars. You ever notice how these newer cars, when someone passes you in your blind spot, the little light comes on?
Yep.
All of those are microchips. If you have anything with power seats, anything to do with traction control, they're all small microchips. And it makes our lives very convenient. And you can't have production without it. So what does the U.S. do? They destabilize the country. And then they could come in and do what they really want to do. Now, pardon me, no corona. Read.
A new global study from IPC finds 9 in 10 manufacturers report rising costs. Vast majority see lack of qualified talent in North America and globally. A new global survey found that the global shortage of semiconductors and other components continues to have serious consequences for electronics manufacturers.
So there's a global shortage, meaning the national and international, rather, shortage of semiconductors and other components in order to get their products for electronics manufacturers. So a little bit later on, I want to go and find out, and tech team, I want you to research real quick, what are the minerals and alloys that are needed to produce common microchips and other, I think, is that the word, microchips? I want to find that out, because I don't know the answer to that, all right? You got something already?
Now you're going to look.
All right.
They're looking it up.
Read on. We're going to do a little research tonight. Come on.
Leading to rising costs and higher prices. The survey conducted by IPC, the Global Electronics Manufacturing Association, also found that companies continue to face difficulty in finding qualified talent, with only 15% of respondents indicating that the situation is improving.
Because smart people know that if you can't get chips, how are you going to have a job? So they're trying to say, well, we can't find the talent. Man, no, because the wars that are going behind the scenes, you can't get the chips. And how do we know this? Because look at it, the industries are being affected. This company, was it IBC?
IPC.
You don't need to show me. Let's show that off. So Build Electronics Better, IPC. Now, IPC is an international company that is, they're experts in this. They did a survey, and they're a global electronics manufacturing association. So they're not just, they know this business in and out. So now, scroll where it says,
even as sales expectations for electronics manufacturers have improved, they face increases to both material and labor costs, leading to declining inventories and increasing backlogs around the globe.
So now, they like to throw that about the labor in there, and I believe that a lot of that is BS. The inventory. Yes, sir.
They can't complain about the labor when they made most of their labor force quit because they didn't want to take a jab.
That's right.
We was looking at the shipping crisis like, oh, we don't have people to unload the ships. We don't have people to scan the stuff on the docks. We don't have truck drivers to drive the stuff there. Well, guess what? That's not the only industry that's affected by this stuff. This man-made disease that came upon the earth that Esau put out there and tried to force everybody in order to take a shot, now their electronics field is impacted now.
100%. You're going to infect the population as a result, you're going to see. But for today's focus, there's a problem getting certain minerals to create these chips. There's a problem. And guess what? What do thieves do? When it gets tough, they just go and start crap and take other people's stuff. That's the American way.
Yep.
That's the you're living in America.
Yep.
All right. So, we would just add
back to the article.
Yes, please.
All right. The longer the shortage crisis continues unresolved, the more difficult it will be to overcome these compounding problems and return to normal.
So. Just leave the article, please. You don't have to come back to me, please. Thank you. So what we're going to find is that Esau, the American capitalist system wants answers, and they want answers now. So what does Esau do? Esau will find, well, you know what? If we send our CIA and our troops in to destabilize, now what we can do is we can create a situation where now international help is needed. We need to get involved quickly. And then guess what happens? And then you get these American companies that will come in so far as to be the saviors and set up shop because they have the natural resources to get the United States what it needs, and they'll mask it with the guys where they're given relief funding. They'll get their foot in the door, and then they will set up shop, and then it will be less reliance on the Far East countries like China and these other countries, Malaysia, these other, where the chips we're getting them from now. That's what this is all about. And oil, too. It's also about the oil, too. Read on.
Among other conclusions, the survey results found that the six-month outlook for electronics manufacturing as a result of the supply chain crisis has deteriorated again. The expectations for sales have improved, but material costs, labor costs, inventories and backlogs are all expected to continue to get worse.
Now, y'all can read the rest of this article on your own. Scroll down a little bit. I want to see if there was some, I thought there was something about the certain minerals that they were trying that's hard for them to get. And if it's not in this article, if you could look, if y'all did a little research work, because beautiful, put that up there. Because Esau is they're very wise when they plan things, and they know exactly what they're doing. Okay, we go. So this is just a Google search. It says, what minerals are needed to make microchips? So
digital gold,
go ahead.
Silicone is the material of choice in the chip industry. Unlike the metals normally used to conduct electrical currents, silicone is a semiconductor, meaning that its conductive properties can be increased by mixing it with other materials such as phosphorus or boron.
So silicone is that's not that uncommon of a material, but I think there's something else.
All right, that right there. Computer chips and processors have three materials that contribute to the bulk of their designs. Uh-huh. Silicone, plastic, and copper. Silicone dioxide comes from either silica sand or from quartz.
Okay, now, that's important. Because copper is a very valuable mineral. Quartz is also mined. These are things that are mined. But I know there's more. They're just giving us the general information. Is there more? Look at that. Stick up my hand. That was accidental. You see that? You got to be kidding. That's what, hey, you realize that bishop, man. Bishop could do some crazy, just some stuff. Not even mean to do it. And look, he's throwing up. Thank the Lord, man. I'll tell you something. Bishop, man. All praise to the Lord. Bishop has got an extra layer of patience because I just saw that. Damn, what are they? I got the damn symbol up. Okay, silicone. No problem.
That's all right, Cap. Whatever happens, I got one of those $1 million coins. I'll just buy you out of jail. Whatever.
Right. Exactly.
You know, in 2016, we gave out $1 million coins. You know, we was minting our own money.
Man, this is crazy. So, that's okay. So let's go back to that video because, by the way, this keeps coming up by the hour. RT News has got some great updates. By the hour, this is happening right now. They're sending coalition forces in there, Russian coalition forces, to stop this uprising, and they're killing people. They're killing the citizens over there because they're like, let's just say, for example, it's $4 a gas, and then tomorrow it's $8 a gas. You know how people are going to be going crazy in this country? Imagine that happening in the U.S., people protesting, going to the Capitol building, and as you're doing these things, you have a government that is saying, nah, get back in your houses, and you refuse to go, they're killing them. This is what they're dealing with right now. In the U.S., hey, don't think it couldn't happen here.
And the U.S. does have an embassy there. They have an embassy in Kazakhstan. Wherever there's an embassy, there's an interest. Mm-hmm. That's why they said, look, we're just watching from far. We're watching from a distance to see what's going on, to make sure that Russia and China handle the situation, because Russia and China is the allies of Kazakhstan. All right? So keep that in mind. Russia and China are the allies of Kazakhstan.
Yes, that YouTube. Yes, please. Because we didn't finish that. I think it was... So this is good because it gives you a general understanding. But in y'all research, we just want to bring you to where, make you aware of the situation, because the destabilization is something behind it. And it's to prepare us to know that this can happen in this country. And if this were to happen in this country and gas prices were to effectively double, even if gas prices went up $1 tomorrow, you would see people would struggle. Because now you got a real problem. Some people might not be able to choose between, I might not be able to get to work this week.
Hey, Cap.
All right?
Look at what happened. Look at what happened 1 year ago today. Today's the 6th, right?
Yeah.
Right.
Yep. Today's the 6th.
Capitol riot.
What happened last year when they couldn't get their way? Mm-hmm. They blasted the Capitol and they killed a couple people. So just like Cap's saying, it can happen here. Don't think that it can't. We live in this Western American bubble and we think that the outside world is full of boogeymen and all of the safety is here. No.
If they evoke martial law and you do not comply with the martial law, they are allowed to use, they have military weapons, and they can and they will, to restore order, do what they have to do. And a lot of jakes in this country think that they're Edomites and they're going to get a wake-up call quick. Real quick.
A Cap. September of 2005, right here in New Orleans, Louisiana, right, we saw what could happen with martial law when they did not allow people that were drowning to go across the bridge to the West Bank. They had them stare down with armed military. Yep. It could happen here. It has happened here.
You know what's heavy, Mikhail? This is why Esau, man, Esau. So when I first moved down here, I was in people's houses, and one thing about Esau, a lot of times Esau would see color. So they might, maybe he's a Puerto Rican or whatever. So this spilling his guts to me. He was a cop on that bridge. He was a Gretna cop. And I was in this. I didn't understand really what he was talking about. And he said he felt very guilty because he was given orders that they would not allow anyone to cross the bridge, just what you're saying. And he was just kind of sharing things that was hard for him to live with because a lot of people died and were picked off trying to get across the bridge to save. And some of the folks lived in Algiers trying to get home. They lived because New Orleans has a West Bank area, which is called Algiers, the Algiers area. It's part of New Orleans, even though it's on the other side of the river. And so some people were just trying to get to their families that lived across the bridge, but they would not allow them to go. And there was, and so I heard it from the enemy. And he that's that guilt that they have. So and I heard a lot of people die, man. A lot of brothers got put to death. And so it can happen here, and it's going to happen here. And this is why we need to be prepared. When you see things like that in the spirit, we have to know. And look, here's the thing. There are some of our brothers in Kazakhstan. There are Israelites that are in Kazakhstan. So with that, we're about to get ready to take a break. All praise to the Most High. Thank you. We're halfway through the show. We're just getting started. If you're just joining us, we're looking to Kazakhstan and the uprising and what is behind this mass rioting and the suppression by the government. And what can we as Israelites learn from this so that if and when it does happen here, you're not surprised. But you better be prepared. So all praise to the Most High. With that, we're going to go to commercial. Thanks for tuning in. Hang on with us. Shalom.
If I had a prison where I want to be, you could see me running to the battleground. Front line, first infantry. I want to be the first one there to get down. I would die on a daily. I'm coming up to sacrifice me right now. Put me in the army of the Most. Put me in the army of the Most High. Milk dripping from my cheek, but I put down the rattle, for thou was girding me with strength.
Shalom, shalom. Welcome back to Precept Upon Precept. We're jumping right back into Kazakhstan. Those of you who've been following that. And just a quick rehash. Why is it important? Number one, those are not our people. Now, there are Israelites, according to Isaiah 11, verse 11, according to Deuteronomy 28, verse 64, we go into all nations. That is true. Those are an Islamic nation who as a race, they're a mixture of ancient Turks and certain, they look like a, they Asian look to them, right? Some of our people do live over there scattered, but why is it important that we're going over this? Because this outrage of the citizens in their country could happen here. Imagine if the gas prices doubled tomorrow in this country. What would happen, like Officer Matt brought out earlier? Last year to this day, they stormed the Capitol because of the political dissatisfaction of Donald Trump effectively losing or the election slipping away to Sleepy Joe, right? So not that I like Joe Biden, don't love Joe Biden. So why is this important? Because the destabilization, if you go up right below, do me a favor, I'm going to repost it so you can just pull up. And I do know, Officer Ock, that this is actually just a link, but I want to play this. I just posted it again to make it easier for us. If look where it says real motive. So RT News is a great non-Caucasian perspective, I can say that. They give you a little bit different or an un-American perspective. So all I'm looking to do is just pull this short tidbit up. And we're going to follow along because they're not stupid. And they know that there's foreign entities at work here. I just posted it. Thank you, sir. All right, so we're going to go. Why is it in black and white? Oh, so you, when you click on it, it won't just pull up like it was supposed to? I got you. Okay. Understood. I get it. All right. I'll tell you what. Let me. Damn it. That's my fault. I'm just going to read it. Let me read it. So this is from RT News. Okay. It says, foreign spy agencies behind Kazakh riots claim Serbian president Vučić, or whatever his name is. So Serbian president Aleksandar Vučić claims foreign intelligence agencies are responsible for the violent, deadly chaos in Kazakhstan right now and predicts it will leave thousands dead in a ravaged country for years. So the total cost of damage estimated approximately 92, I'm assuming that's million, according to the National Chamber of Entrepreneurs, as shopping centers and businesses continue to be looted. So what does that mean? A destabilization by a foreign government? That's the alphabet boys. That's your CIA. That's your other American acronym agencies that go in and they destabilize. But Antifa is a domestic version of that. Antifa would come in, and then you got these dumb jakes that follow behind them. They're set up and paid and funded to go cause this upheaval, and then they dip before the thing hits the fan. Or if they go to jail, they got lawyers waiting to get them out there. They're funded behind the scenes. That's what's going on over there. And a lot of these other countries around them who don't think like American Western philosophy, they have an authoritarian government. A lot of them are different. They're not even Christians. Most of them are Islamic. Yep. So they don't think like the so-called white man in the U.S. And they know what the hell's going on. Why? Because they're rich in minerals. It's the strongest and political and economic country in all of Central Asia. We just read that. That's what's going on there. Showing you that Esau's hand is in other people's business. Why? Because he's mad because he can't get his microchips from China because they're holding things back. So he's got to go destabilize the country to go steal something else and put his foot in other people's business. That's exactly what's going on right now. Now, is that it on that? And Officer Matt, you were saying something, Officer Matt, about the Bitcoin and about how Kazakhstan literally can directly affect what's going on with the Bitcoin.
Oh, yes.
You pulled that up.
Oh, yes.
Officer Matt, go into that, please.
Yes, pull up that article. Pull up that article. Those of y'all who are trading in coins, cryptocurrencies and things of that nature. The stuff that's going on in Kazakhstan directly impacts all of that. Those of y'all who have been keeping up with the stocks and the crypto market, Bitcoin has been down. Like, it's down to like 47,000 a coin right now. And that's like the lowest it's been in a long time. Mm-hmm. It was just at like 53, you know? So you got to look at what's going on. We got the article ready? It was at 60, right. So let's see. Bitcoin dives after Kazakhstan kills internet. Former Soviet Republic, the world's second largest mining hub, is facing major internet disruptions amid a nationwide anti-government protest. Bitcoin has seen a sharp decline as protests continue in Kazakhstan, the world's second largest mining hub, where internet was shut down, forcing local miners to switch off their equipment. The world's leading cryptocurrency dropped to $42,786, which marked a daily drop off of nearly 8.5%, extending losses recorded during the previous session. The decline occurred after network data provider NetBlocks reported significant disruption to internet service in Kazakhstan from the evening of Tuesday, 4th of January, 2022, progressing to a nation-scale communications blackout on Wednesday afternoon. The normalized network connectivity in Kazakhstan reported fell to 2%. So when you look at this, the fact that the internet was down in Kazakhstan made the Bitcoin drop. Why? Because the mining that takes place, the money that they get from mining is invested into Bitcoin. The mining, because Kazakhstan is the second largest mining hub in the world, meaning they mine for oil, they mine for petroleum, they mine for silica, they mine for quartz, they mine for copper, they mine for gold, they mine for all of these different minerals in this place, all of which is being invested heavily into cryptocurrencies. But you can't invest if you have no internet.
Hey, real quick, I just posted an article. And what Officer Matt is saying is that, and it's amazing how we in the West, a lot of us have not up until now really heard that much about this Kazakhstan, right? It's the ninth largest country. It is the most powerful economic country in Central Asia. And guess what? The population is less than 20 million people. So the population density is far and few between. That's why it's one of the safer places that they rated it. It's like a first world country that is even higher rated than Germany and France to go visit. Now all of a sudden it's destabilized. Interesting. This is real time. It came in 2 hours ago, hot off the press, if you will. I'm not sure about the source. It is commodities. So commodities is quite clearly is dealing with oil as a commodity, gas is a commodity, food is a commodity, minerals are a commodity. So this is a commodities article. Is that the name of the
It's a trade. Trust me, it's a trade.
Okay, beautiful. Look, this just came in. It says oil prices jump on supply worries. It didn't say they're just, so to your point, they're just worried about what's going on. So now let's take a look at this article.
Melbourne, January 7th, Reuters. So it's credible, it's Reuters. Oil prices rose on Friday as an uprising in Kazakhstan stoked worry that crude supply from the OPEC producer could be disrupted at the same time output has dropped in Libya.
Right, hang on, scroll up real quick. I want to make sure this is not wrong. I'll scroll back up. Sometimes they do this. It says, stop right there, go to the picture. Oil tankers are seen parked at a yard outside a fuel depot on the outskirts of Kolodia, February 3rd, 2015. That might be an old picture, but I want to see if time. I want to make sure this is real news. Scroll down a little bit. It is, well, it's updated 3 hours ago, 8:29, January. Say, okay, all right, let's go. Huh? Okay. Sit up. Yes.
Brent crude futures climbed 48 cents or 0.6% to $82.47 a barrel at 127 Great Mountain Time, adding to a 1.5% jump in the previous session. U.S. West Texas Intermediate crude futures rose 50 cents or 0.6% to $79.96 a barrel, extending a 2.1% gain in the previous session. The upward jump in oil prices mostly reflects the market jitters as unrest escalates in Kazakhstan and the political situation in Libya continues to deteriorate and sideline oil output.
Now, listen to this.
Wow.
Kazakhstan is in Central Asia. Libya is in North Africa, correct?
Correct.
So just the unrest that's happening in the last couple of days and the fear of that is affecting what's happening in Northeast Africa. That is the power of this man causing political and social unrest, and it's all being done to farm and harvest future business in this country. You got to see for what it is. It's amazing.
Remember that first article you pulled that said that Kazakhstan was very powerful economically and politically.
Right.
So this article here proves that Kazakhstan is giving oil to Libya. Libya and Kazakhstan have a business relationship, and because of this unrest that's going on, Libya's oil output is affected.
Right.
Bitcoin is affected. Who else is going to be affected by this?
Man, y'all really need to see how the Bible is a true book. Remember when we read in Micah, it talked about who enlarges his borders as hell. Mm-hmm. They do these things knowing, but guess what? God is allowing this to happen because let's think about it. You have Russia, you have China, you create political unrest, and guess what? The U.S. is involved. Guess where this is at? It's not too far from the land of Jehoshaphat. Remember it talks about with the valley of Jehoshaphat, the valley of decision?
Yep.
The Most High is mustering all these things. Remember it talks about how in the last days it would be like a woman in travail. First you'd have some calm times, and then as she goes through her contraction, it gets heated up, right? This is what we're seeing. We're going through the times. It's calm, and then it heats up, and it goes up. And the Lord's mustering all this, all right? Let's go back to that article real quick, and we're going to scroll down a little bit more. Because let me not lean back in my chair. It says, let's read on, where it says, after days of unrest.
After days of unrest in Kazakhstan, during which the government declared a state of emergency.
Stop. This is only days of unrest. This is not a month. This is not a week. This is just days. And it's causing Libya, a country that's somewhat far away, to raise their prices in fear of what might happen. It's only been a couple of days so far, all right?
Hey, Cap.
Yes, sir.
Chess move. If a country has unrest and their allies are not able to calm that unrest,
right,
then the United Nations now has to come in. And who runs the United Nations? The United States of America. Then they have to come in, and then they have to do something about it because we tried to let you handle it. It didn't work, so now we have to step in and handle it. And when they step in and handle it, now they have to control everything. Democracy has to come in, and with democracy comes embargoes, it comes structure, it comes the takeover, their political allies destabilize everything.
Sin comes in.
Go ahead, Mikhail.
I said sin comes in with democracy.
Yep.
So-called Christianity comes in with democracy.
Yep.
Hey, you on point, because that's heavy what you said. With democracy, hand-in-hand with Christianity. Pull up, go to Wikipedia real quick. Let's look at Kazakhstan and type in religious or religious affiliation. It's going to give us the breakdown. Generally, it might be off by a percentage or two. It's going to tell you, remember, Christianity, it walks hand-in-hand with democracy.
Mm-hmm.
But you're going to find that the folks over there who have kind of an Asian looking, like ancient Turkish looking, they look a little different, right? It's kind of hard. They look like a mixture of races, right? But you're going to find they don't play that. Most of them are not Christian, okay? You got that in Wikipedia? About 5 seconds. All right, so look. This is amazing. This is happening right now as we speak. Hour by hour, right now, much of the world's economy is changing right before our eyes. Just log online. It's going on right now. Okay?
So, Kazakhstan religion. Ethnic Kazakhs are primarily Sunni Muslims.
You see that? Sunni, they're Islamic. Sunni Muslims. Okay? If I know you Googled, is it too hard to get Wikipedia? Because Wikipedia will actually give you a breakdown.
Yeah, they had it right underneath it.
Oh, okay. There we go. Yeah, beautiful.
The religion of Kazakhstan.
So,
all right. According to various polls, the majority of Kazakhstan citizens, primarily ethnic Kazakhs, identify as non-denominational Muslims, while others incline towards Sunni of the Hanafi school, traditionally including ethnic Kazakhs, who constitute about 68.5% of the population, as well as ethnic Uzbeks, Uyghurs, and Tatars. Less than 1% are a part of the Shafi, primarily Chechens, and the Shia.
Real quick. Scroll down a little bit. Let's look at that pie graph, and let's check this out. Because remember, democracy walks hand in hand with Christianity. So we can see just, and let's say it's wrong by percentage of two, right? Because it said various polls, right? So let's just say they're off by a little bit. So if we look at that large, and we go right back to grade school, all right? Look at that green large chunk of the pie, Islam, mainly non-denominational Muslims, and another higher number of Hanafi Muslims. So damn near three-quarters of the entire country is Islamic. Now, look at the next one. The next biggest piece of the pie is Christianity. So what the U.S. knows is this. There is a foothold of Christians there. So what you do is just the same way you victimize the Christians that are there. Create a backdrop of a story that they're being oppressed and their good Christian values are being targeted. Now it gets international attention. And with the layer of turmoil that was created by destabilization through foreign entities that the other neighboring nations know that's going on. That's why the U.S. is saying, we're not doing nothing wrong. You create a perfect storm for democracy and Christianity to start turning and infiltrating in that country. Look at the geographic position of that land. Now, imagine if the U.S. gets a foothold in that country. Look, it's right in whose backyard? It's right in the backyard of China and Russia.
Yep.
Here's the thing. You think Russia and China going to take this land down?
Nope.
This is where the Most High is going to come in and muster the battle. I pray the Lord it happens. If life lasts, the Lord make this thing happen in our lifetime. Because when all that happens and the war start and the things start going off and imminent, ultimately it will be a nuclear thermal war. And once that comes, it means we get ready to go home. Deliverance is coming. So don't be we don't need to be worried. Like Bishop say, don't be worried. Just be aware, know what's going on, make sure we're walking right with the Most High, and understand that this, what's going on, this social and political turmoil and unrest and violence that's going on right now could very easily happen right here to the point where it could affect us. Let gas prices double. See how it's going to affect you directly. How would you get to work? How does that, when food prices go up by 40% in 2 weeks, what are you going to do? Medicine goes up. But guess what? You think they're going to give you a 40% raise at your job to offset the cost of that? No, they're not. They're not going to do that. So we got to be mindful and prepare. Prepare our minds. It could very well happen here.
Hey, IT team, could y'all bring up that map that we had of Kazakhstan earlier? The big one where you can see everything real clearly. Since Cap is talking about the Most High muster in the battle, I want to show y'all something. Let me show y'all something real, real heavy. It should be the big one where Kazakhstan was in green, right under Russia in gray, that map, you can see everything clearly on that one. Because all this is Bible prophecy. All this is going into, you know, the end times and apocalyptic writings about Gog and Magog.
So you mean to tell me that the love of Jesus ain't over there in that area right now?
No, it ain't.
The love of Jesus is not over there right now?
If you know what the love of Jesus truly is.
I'm talking about the Christianity love of Jesus.
Oh, not that.
Like, hug your brother.
Esau's not trying to go over there and hug people? Nope.
Why they not trying to go over there and hug people? But they want us to hug everybody over here, though.
Yeah, they want you to turn the other cheek, too, so they can hit you on that one, too.
They're not gonna turn the other cheek over there?
Nope. Hey, y'all got that map yet?
I mean, they should really hold true to the principles of Islam and Christianity, okay?
Right.
And love one another, because Islam is an all-inclusive religion, just like Christianity, okay? They should just be there.
Matter of fact, Islam is the sister of Christianity.
Yes, they should be there and love one another and hold hands, okay? And pray the hate away.
Hey, look.
You know, they should pray the hate away over there in Kazakhstan. They really should.
Hey, just so y'all know, yes, Islam really is the sister of Christianity. Christianity mixed pagan sun worship with Jewish ideals, and Islam mixed pagan moon worship with those Jewish ideals from the Bible. So these are those two sister religions that were actually created during, what do they call that? The one they always want to go to?
The Council of Nicaea.
Yeah. Y'all got that for me? I pull that up real quick because it's something about this Caspian Sea that I want to show y'all.
Mm.
All right. Well, when we get the map, y'all going to see the Caspian Sea.
Hey, real quick, give me Psalms 55:21. Y'all bear with us, the tech team. We're coming back. We got a brother in training right now. Bear with us. We know we slow. Bear with us. So what we're going to find is that America is very, very, Esau in general, but especially this American Caucasian, is very, very smooth with his diplomatic game. And when questioned about the involvement, everything is smooth. Mm-hmm. But behind the scenes, this man is creating a perfect storm to create a violent uprising so that, like the officers mentioned earlier, you have to send NATO. You have to send the peacekeeping faction in to create world peace. But then you have Russia that is affiliated with them. They're their neighbor. They don't want them coming in and trying to dictate what's going to happen in that land. Neither does China, okay, for that matter. So let's read Psalms 55:20.
The book of Psalms, chapter 55 and verse 21. The words of his mouth were smoother than butter.
Jump to verse 20 first.
Verse 20. He had put forth his hand against such as be at peace with him.
And so what you're going to find is that this country received its independence from the USSR back in 1990, and it was established in 1991. They had the same president for over 25 years, and it was a peaceful place. They just had a changing of the guard where the president's been, I think it's been 2 years and 2.5 years or so, something like that. And now all of a sudden, this first-rate country is now destabilized.
Sounds like somebody had a talking to.
Mm-hmm.
Something's going on. And it just so happened with the COVID-19, the delay in shipping, manufacturer, we read earlier from the IBC article, that they're having trouble getting certain precious minerals to create these microchips. All of this is kind of, it just kind of doesn't jive up, right? Or does it? Read on. Let the Bible explain to you what's going to happen.
He had broken his covenants He had broken his covenant. His words, the words of his mouth, were smoother than butter.
So, and then they all know, all these countries know, this foreign involvement. And did we find the video when the white woman was basically explaining that the U.S. has nothing to do with this? Because do you see Australia doing that? Do you see Indians from East India saying, we have nothing to do? That's a terrible story. But do you see them doing that?
Nope.
Do you see South Africans saying that? Why do they have to say they have nothing to do with it?
The words of his mouth were smoother than butter. But war was in his heart.
So war, what is it? We got the map up. Mickey, you better jump on that while we got the map up.
So if you look at Kazakhstan, right next to Kazakhstan is the Caspian Sea. Now, I posted a Wikipedia about Gog and Magog, right? Hey, I posted that Wikipedia about Gog and Magog. Could y'all scroll to that and go to the link where it says Alexander the Great? I want to show y'all something about the Caspian Sea and the Caspian Mountains. Mm.
Want to start at a legend or?
No, I don't want the paragraph that talks. I want the link that actually says Alexander the Great. Go down to that link, please.
We're going to be better next week, y'all, because this is, we're going to get it right.
What part you want?
It should say, Josephus recounts the tradition. That's where I want to start at. As soon as you click on the link where it says Alexander the Great, it has the picture, and then it says the first century Jewish historian. You on the Wikipedia that says Gog and Magog? Scroll to where it says, they got the links that say names, Jewish texts, Christian texts, Islamic texts, and then Alexander the Great.
So this, like Mickey, I was going to get into this. This has historical, I'm sitting down, excuse me. This has historical significance in this land with the Caspian Sea. And there's a history about this land. This land is something that is not just rich in minerals and natural resources, which is the U.S. is going to use and manipulate and steal and then perhaps set up a military base there and then be in the backyard of China, which China and Russia are not going to want to allow that. But all this is mustering, and this destabilization is being caused in a relatively, before this, peaceful first world country. You got it up?
They say they got it.
Okay, all praises.
At peace for 25 years, and then 2 years later.
Right. All right. So where it says Josephus recounts, read that, just that one sentence.
Josephus recounts the tradition that Gog and Magog were locked up by Alexander the Great behind iron gates in the Caspian Mountains.
Watch this part.
Generally identified with the Caucasus Mountains.
So who's in the Caucasus Mountains? This is Esau. This is his area. This is where he's at.
So Esau is fighting against Esau. Internal conflict.
The Most High is gathering all these people together in that area. Gog and Magog are prophesied to be the end times war. This is all happening right there.
Hey, go to the Wikipedia article that I posted. Get the camera off me, please. Got my brother asking for water on camera. We all recovered. We have recovered. Go to that Wikipedia article. I want to show you something. It's just a Wikipedia article, the history of Kazakhstan. Yep. History of Kazakhstan. All right, now.
All praises.
I want you to show something. I want to show you something. Scroll down. Scroll. Stop.
Ooh.
So, I had to pull an ancient map, Cap.
Right.
Pull an ancient map. Now, awesome Mikael, I want you to get Acts chapter 2 real quick. Cap said something earlier. He said that there are our people, there are Israelites in these areas, right, in Kazakhstan. That blue above Parthia and right below Scythia,
yeah,
that's the Caspian Sea.
Uh-huh.
It's exactly where Officer Mikael was just pointing at. Now go to Acts chapter 2. We're going to read verse 7.
The book of Acts chapter 2 and verse 7. And they were amazed and marveled, saying one to another, behold, are not all these which speak Galilean? And how hear we every man in his own tongue wherein we were born?
So remember, this is Pentecost. This is in Jerusalem. All of the Jews came from all over to come be in Jerusalem. And they said, hey, ain't these men from Galilee? How are they speaking in the language that I was born? Let's see where they was born from.
Verse 9, Parthians.
What?
Parthians.
Go back to the map. So you had Jews that was from Parthia.
That's right.
That was from Parthia. And they came to Jerusalem to keep Pentecost.
Uh-huh.
Oh, my goodness. But that it don't stop there. Go to Colossians 3 and 11. Let's see. So you had our people from Parthia, because guess what? Why is the Lord starting to muster up the battle in there? Because some of our people are there. And he's going to fight for his elect.
Mm.
He's going to fight for his elect. Don't think that this Kazakhstan thing is just some people over there that we don't know about. Oh, no. Those are our people, some of our people over there.
Colossians chapter 3 and verse 11. Where there is neither Greek nor Jew,
uh-huh,
circumcision nor uncircumcision,
uh-huh,
barbarian, Scythian,
ooh,
bond nor free, but Christ is all and in all.
So Scythian, those people that come from Scythia. So you have our people who are in Scythia. You have our people who are in Parthia right now. Go guess where those areas are. That Scythia right now is modern day Kazakhstan.
Kazakhstan and Russia. And
right. And you know what, Sebi? Leave this map up, because sometimes you just got to let Esau help you. Officer Matt is pulling this map up, and you might say, well, how do we know that that's talking about the time of Acts? Because look to your left. It tells you the Roman Empire.
Boom.
So when Paul was writing to the Colossians, Paul was under the Roman, or the Holy Roman Empire. So we know that this time period, and you could Google it on your own, this time period is exactly, and there were Israelites, and that's a vast empire. Scythia and Parthia, I mean, that's Parthia, the eastern boundary, is not too far from Israel.
Right.
Right.
But that goes deep. And now a lot of Israelites were there. But they also, it says, the Turkish tribes. Because today, a lot of those folks look like they're Asian-looking.
Uh-huh.
And it's a mixture of, because their border in China, it's a mixture of an Asian look with that of an ancient Turkish look. And some of our people, just like the Gadites over here, some Israelites might have that look. That's why we got to judge not according to appearance, but judge righteous judgment. Some of our people are not going to look like doggone Wesley Snipes, okay? They're not going to look exactly like the rest of the Israelites. So this is heavy as, and guess what? This is what this means. I'm glad you brought this out. We're already out of time. But we are going to, we're almost out of time, we are going to have to go to that land one day and teach.
Yep.
We're going to have to, guess what? We're going to have brothers that's going to wake up in that land who are going to speak the language of Kazakhstan, and we're going to have to send troops out to send boots on the ground, and guess what? Wake up our people that's there. We got biblical proof that Officer Matt pulled from the time of the Roman Empire. We got the maps to cross-reference. And why is this all important? Historically valued, we could probably do a whole show just on that, pull up a lot of ancient maps, but also know that some of you might not recall, but some of you are old enough, but in the year 2007, the market was bubbling up to the point where that they were giving loans out on signatures. Anybody could get a loan, and it was an old saying that is, when you write a check, now you're going to have to cash it at one point. So when they started to call their loans in, right, the bubble busted. And there were whole towns, the street that I lived on, unfortunately, I was involved in that. I got a predatory loan, all that BS. Half the homes on my street got foreclosed on, and the whole country in 2008 was the bubble busted. Millions and millions of people lost their home. And it went into a economic recession in this country. Gas prices during that time, y'all, a lot of y'all remember, went up to $4.60, some $5 a gallon. And that was crazy back then. I remember I was a school teacher. I could barely have the gas to pay my mortgage and get to work. I remember that like it was yesterday. So just the math, and a lot of y'all know, y'all in your 40s and some of your 50s, even some of your late 30s, y'all remember those days. 5-minute warning. So y'all got, listen, we're not far from that. That could happen in our country. That was a first-rate country. The most powerful economic and political country in Central Asia in 2 to 3 days. Look what it did to the world's economy. Look what it did to Libya, the oil prices in Libya. And that was just from the social upheaval of the doubling of gas prices affects the world now. And this is going on right now, tonight, tomorrow. Google, wake up in the morning, Google Kazakhstan. Look what's going on right now. It's going to happen tomorrow, and it's going to change what's happening in the world.
It's affecting the United States right now today. There are brothers in the congregation who said their jobs, which are refineries, are closing down because they can't get the chips.
Can you call in? We have time. Can
I don't think we have a setup yet.
We don't have a setup for
We have a brother. I'm just read something real quick. You in the spirit, Mikael. We got a brother right now. I ain't going to say his name. A brother was, I don't know if he's watching right now, but we have a brother that has a fairly good job working at a refinery. And what telegram is it on? Is it on soldiers? Okay. So now, one of our brothers, good brother, loyal brother, he types this. He said, facts, my refinery is shutting down because the chips that control the DCS, I think that's something to do with digital control something, computer system we run at the refinery will take six months to arrive. The job I work at, normally we could get generators in about 14 business days or less. We're telling people 6 to 8 months you're going to have to anticipate waiting. It is because of that, you think they can wait 6 months to run a refinery? They're going to stop shy. They're going to do something else. Whole industries are going to be shut down. This is directly affecting. This just came in an hour ago, right? Something like that? Yep. Not too long ago. You are going to see, look, it's high time we, listen, Israel, it's high time. We're not, most are not playing. We got to get our minds right. The Deacon Asaph, the deacons of IUIC, the bishops have been preparing us. It's about to get real, and it's about to get real quick. If Libya is changing, how do you know that the U.S. might see that? Okay, yeah, they got other people. You get oil from Saudi Arabia. But guess what? If Kazakhstan is not producing the oil, or they raise their price, guess what? The other manufacturers are not going to keep their price $4 a barrel lower. No, the whole industry is going to be affected based upon that. So in the next week, you could see a dollar, gas prices going to a dollar. Next week, we don't know what could happen. That's why we got to keep these commandments, pray, fast for one another. Y'all get your food pantry stored up. Y'all start growing these community gardens. You women need to learn how to preserve food, canned food, dehydrate food. Y'all need to learn this. Y'all have backyards, and you spend all this money in these zero-turn lawnmowers and all these stupid push mowers to cut your grass. You better start plugging fruit trees in the ground. You better start learning how to get a damn green thumb. You better start learning how to raise your own vegetables, control the food that comes in, and start stockpiling it up. And when it's not to say this to put you in a frenzy. This is happening right now. The whole country, why would they rise up? They know what's going to happen to them. If they don't rise up and try to challenge this, people are going to die. Food is going to get so high that it's going to be hard to choose between eating, medicine, lights on. These are real choices that people got to make. And guess what? We saw that in the Great Depression in the 1920s in this country. Okay, we saw it when the bubble busted in 2007, 2008. Okay, we saw it. There's been many times in American history where we've seen it. Look what happened in Venezuela last year, 2 years ago. The whole country is when Chavez, was it Chavez? Chavez went down, imploded. It was one of the top economic forces in all the Western Hemisphere. And then and next thing you know, they it's $10 to buy a damn piece of loaf of bread. So destabilization is a real thing, okay? It's happening right before your eyes. Y'all track this. Y'all track this. Watch the news. Don't just, like Bishop always say, don't just watch ABC, CNN. Look at other non-American media outlets to get some of your news, okay? They're going to give you a non-Western Caucasian point of view.
Hey, Cap, real quick. I know we're out of time. Real quick, in Google, put in Kazakhstan main export. Because they threw words around like alloys, ferro alloys, and stuff like that. I wanted to just really prove everything that we was talking about earlier. Just Google Kazakhstan main export and just keep it on that homepage. All right, right there. Kazakhstan has an export-oriented economy highly dependent on shipments of oil and related products, 73% of total exports. In addition to oil, its main export commodities include ferrous metals, which are those ferroalloys, copper, aluminum, zinc, and uranium, all of which are used to make those chips that Cap was just talking about, all of it. Kazakhstan is one of the biggest exporters of all of those metals and oil and gas. There's a reason why that country was picked, just like there's a reason why Venezuela was picked a couple years ago.
Right. You said it. Because Venezuela was one of the major production hubs of oil in the southern, southwestern hemisphere. Can we get that article? I know we the last show, so we go over about 5 minutes. I want that where the white, the when I say white, because we know it's American, Caucasian, please find where they're justifying and explaining that the U.S. had nothing to do with the turmoil that's going on. Can we find that? I know it's last minute, but it might be CNN. If we can't find it, it is what it is. You know what? I don't. I saw the damn article. If you type in Kazakhstan, and it might be on a YouTube, like most popular feed, something of that nature. But look, while we look for that, right now, you've got news stories. If you look up Kazakhstan, you can see stuff that's coming in 2 hours ago, an hour ago. Kazakhstan and Russia rattles region as Russia steps in. This is an hour ago. You've got stuff that's coming in by the minute, by the hour. This is real time what's going on in Kazakhstan, the largest, most powerful economic and political country in Central Asia that is so heavily entrenched in oil and mineral production, metallurgy, as they said, which is, Officer Matt went into about the microchips. All of these things, we're living in a digital empire. We're living where the, what is it called? The information age. I think we're beyond that. What is it called now, you millennials? You're a millennial, Asa. What is it called? The information age. Everything is now, think about the chips that they're able to put in a smartwatch are more advanced than the computers from the 80s. Remember the computers from the 80s, huge computers that took up a whole room? Right now, there was a show years ago called The Jetsons. And it was a family of spacelies, and they lived in outer space. They had these oxygen masks. And me and my brother used to watch it back in, like, the early 80s. And Mr. Spacely and them had watches. And the TV would show up in their watch. And we used to make these jokes like, man, that'll never happen. That could never happen. And about, whatever, 5, 6, 7 years ago, I don't know how, now they have smart watches that link up, and you can watch things on your watch and link up with your earpiece and your cell phone. That is a real thing. And guess what? All of that takes fine-tuned microchips, nanotechnology, all these different types of technology that is farmed and housed in major places like Kazakhstan. I think I said that right. All right, but look, is that we got anything else? We running over. And you didn't find? No, not a problem. So y'all track this. This is, as we speak, we're looking at it right now. Putin sending a coalition from an hour ago. Look at this. Matter of fact, I'm going to send you one more article. I got to look at this one. New York Times just put this article up from 2 hours ago. Look at it. Esau is the devil. I'm going to forward this to you. Post this last article. I know we're going over. And people want to get to bed and go to work tomorrow morning. But I want to show this last one. This is from the New York Times. This is from only a couple of hours ago. And let's look at how they show this picture and how they start this article. This should be a shareable link, off Sakim. Oh, come on, man.
Yeah, with the white woman coming to the defense. Well, it was a white woman that said it, so it should be true. Sheeta might said it, so it has to be true. It has to be real. It's authentic.
You know, the Sheeta mice is like that rich man in the scriptures.
Yeah.
When the Sheeta mice speaks, everybody listens.
Yeah.
All right, check this out. So now, hold up. Let's go back a little bit. I want to see. I like to read. Okay, here we go. White House rips crazy Russian claims of U.S. involvement in Kazakhstan. Now, why is this important that a Russian speaks out? Because who would suffer? What neighbor would suffer more than anybody? It would be Russia. Mm-hmm. Russia is the western, other than the Caspian Sea, and the entire northern border. And guess what? Russia benefits from the economic ties it has to that land. So now the Russian representative that is this is taking place in America. They're on American soil, and this Russian is emboldened to make a claim about America. What would make this man make a claim or a charge against the country that he's in?
Accusation.
Why would he say that? Let's play it.
We've also had seen a lot of instability in Kazakhstan. Mm-hmm. Is that something that the White House has a position on?
Yeah, we have obviously, as you noted, we have seen that, and we have we're monitoring reports of protests in Kazakhstan. We support calls for calm, for protesters to express themselves peacefully, and for authorities to exercise restraint. There are some crazy Russian claims about the U.S. being behind this, so let me just use this opportunity to convey that as absolutely false and clearly a part of the standard Russian disinformation playbook we've seen a lot of in past years. Go ahead.
Okay, so real quick. So I thought that he was the guy that made the claim, but he didn't even make that claim. He was just asking a general question. Why would she have to come on at a press conference and justify that? Because there's some validity,
yeah.
And she has to, what they call, damage control, because the U.S. is involved, just like they were involved when they took over Hawaii, just like they were involved. Why were they in Vietnam? They in Vietnam because they wanted to be in Southeast Asia with the damn Vietnamese? No, they were not. They were trying to get a stronghold to where? The whole Vietnam War was fought over why? Listen, talk to some Vietnam vets. Why were they even there?
To get to Russia.
Think, let's really think. Think about it. Why would they make that claim? The U.S. has got its hand in everything. Why the hell are they celebrating Christmas in Kuwait right now? Before that, there was no... Mike was over there. They did not have Christmas strip clubs and men laying with other men or women at all in that area until the U.S. went over there after Kuwait. The first war was it early 90s, late 80s, whatever it was. Yep. That didn't exist. It did not exist. Now the U.S. has naval fleets in the Persian Gulf that protect that area. Come on, man. We got U.S. military bases are in the Middle East as a result of that. They don't call the U.S. is called the police force of the world. They play good cop, bad cop. The good cop is we come to save you with our foreign aid and our defense and our NATO. But the bad cop is they send and they cause all the problems to begin with.
Hey, Cap.
Y'all better see this for what it is.
Look at the question that the guy asked them. The question that the guy said, yeah, we've noticed some instability. So some destabilization. We've noticed some destabilization, some instabilization in Kazakhstan. Does the White House have any position on that? Why would he say that? Why would he put that word in there with his question? Why? Because when you look at Muammar Gaddafi, destabilization. When you look at what happened with Haiti, destabilization. When you look at what happened in Iraq with Saddam Hussein, destabilization. When you look at Venezuela, destabilization. So anytime destabilization happens, the U.S. is not far behind. That's why he asked that question the way he asked it.
And look at the real quick, Mikhail. Look at the Panama Canal. They had the treaty with the Panama Canal. If your military cannot defend, then the U.S. had a clause in that whole. Y'all watched that whole thing, Bishop Nathaniel Bishop. Y'all also brought that out. So there's a history of the U.S. involvement, and a lot of it is just information you can do with a little bit of searching. You can find out. So. Mikhail, I'm sorry, you were about to say something, brother.
The question, the way it was phrased to her, was a yes or no question. Does the U.S. have a position on this? She could have just said no. But she felt like she had to explain the U.S. involvement out of it. And, you know, that's scriptural. Psalm 64:8 says, you know, the Most High is going to make their own tongue fall on them. And that's exactly what we saw in that video.
So, look, we get ready to wrap up. I know we went over a little bit. Thank you for being patient with us tonight, having patience, rather, with us. Understand this. Y'all track this as it unfolds. The world market for oil and other commodities is being affected as we speak. All right? That's why we got to prepare, keep the commandments, get your food stocks ready, okay? Your pantries, rather. Y'all learn gardening. Y'all learn how to grow these fruit trees. Learn how to grow these crops. Learn how to can, learn how to preserve, learn how to dehydrate. Let's become more self-sufficient so when these famines come, like our forefather Joseph had the understanding from the Most High to prepare, let us prepare as well. Let us search the scriptures. And all this is set up because one day the Israelites are going to be delivered. So anyways, long-winded enough. Y'all, thank you for joining Precept Upon Precept. It's late. We are your host. I'm Captain Shim.
Officer Matthew.
Officer Mikhail.
And with that, we're about to do what? I'm tired. Forgive me. Long day. All right. With that, we say
Shalom.
Shalom.
You listening to Precept on Precept. Kept the shit breaking down to no meat left. Line up on line in the word, make you respect. History collision when we teach your brain is reset. You listening to Precept on Precept. Kept the shit breaking down to no meat left. Line up on line. The word make you respect. History collision when we teach your brain is reset. Putting in the work for the Most High. Valley of the bones coming back and we gon' ride. Showing you our path didn't start with that boat ride. We a nation made a king, till we chose right.
pretend to be that. Judah is something special, they can never be that. We raise avengers with the knowledge so our enemies crack. In fact, listen to the class in the topic. Bomb subject matter, breakdowns atomic, gathering.